Simon & Schuster Audio presents Before I Let You In, a novel by Jenny Blackhurst, read by Jennifer Ness.
Part 1. 1. Now, where would you like to start? Is something funny? That's what I always used to say to my patients. It gives them a sense of control over the session. Except we both know I'm not in control here, don't we? Is it important for you to believe that? I know what you're trying to do. You're trying to put me at ease so I open up and confess my darkest fears, and then you can tell them I'm crazy. I feel crazy. You can write that down. Why don't you start at the beginning, Karen, when you first met Jessica Hamilton? That's not the beginning. It's where all this started, I suppose, but it's not really the beginning. It started way before all that. Before I met B and Eleanor, Michael. It started with what happened when I was 4 years old. Would you like to talk about that? What happened to you when you were a child? No. I don't want to talk about that, and they don't want to hear about it. They want to know about how she died. Go on. You can't fix me. Pardon? Those were some of the first words Jessica Hamilton ever said to me. The words I still hear on a loop in my mind. I remember thinking she was wrong. I fixed people all the time. It was my job. What I didn't realise then was that she never wanted to be fixed in the first place. That was never her intention. I didn't know it yet. But she was there to fix me. 2. Karen. 25th of October. A standard session at the Cecil Baxter Institute was 3,000 seconds long. Some patients spent the entire time in silence, a fact that often confused most of the junior psychiatrists. Why spend £150 to sit mute for 50 minutes? Not Dr. Karen Browning, though. She understood. She understood it in the same way as she understood professional men who visited prostitutes. It wasn't about the money or the silence. It was about the control. The soft click of heels on wooden flooring alerted Karen to the presence of her secretary, Molly, just outside of her office door. Our secretary, she reminded herself. Molly worked for all six of the junior psychiatrists on the second floor. Only the directors on the top floor had personal assistants. There was a light tap on the door. Karen ran some gloss over her lips, slipped the tube back into the top drawer and waited for Molly to come in. All the offices were set like a stage, and Karen was particularly proud of hers, a symbol of everything she had achieved. And don't they say pride comes before a fall? She'd spent an hour before work that morning reading over her case notes for this session, making sure she knew as much about Jessica Hamilton as possible before she even walked through the door. Miss Hamilton was her only new client that week. All the others were ongoing cases, and she had little information about her which irritated her beyond words. Whoever had done the initial referral notes had been nowhere near as thorough as she herself would have been. The scrawling signature on them could have been any of the others, and she made a mental note to bring it up as non-accusatorily as possible at the next team briefing. Age, 23. Medical history, no diagnosed history of depression or generalised anxiety disorder. Family background, unknown. No medication at present. Self-referral. Reason for visit. Tension, headaches, and irrational cognitive activity. As she always did from the initial notes, Karen couldn't help putting together a picture of the woman about to walk through the door. Probably well off, judging from the amount of money she was paying for 50 minutes of Karen's time. Karen did a certain amount of pro bono work, but Jessica Hamilton was self-referred and self-funded. She imagined that her friends called her Jess and her family called her Jessica. There was a second knock, which was unusual for Molly. If Karen's in-session sign wasn't on the door, she usually entered straight away. Karen got up, smoothing down her suit jacket, and opened the door to find not the smiling face of her assistant on the other side, but a slight, timid-looking girl with a pale face, blossoms of red spreading out over her cheeks. Karen hoped her own face had not revealed her surprise. Doubted it had. 8 years of psychiatry had taught her reactions to hover below the surface, never breaking through to the onlooker, the ultimate poker player. The young, attractive, rich girl image the name Jessica Hamilton had conjured up couldn't have been further from the reality standing opposite her now. Karen put out a hand for her to shake, registering quickly the chipped, bitten nails and the grip as weak as the smile she herself offered. Jessica? She cast her eyes around the reception area, but Molly was nowhere to be seen. My apologies. Our receptionist would usually be here to greet you. Come in. She ushered the woman inside, mentally cursing Molly and her out-of-character unprofessionalism. Please, take a seat. Either Jessica Hamilton didn't hear her, or she ignored Karen's request. Instead, she walked slowly away from the sofa and around to the bookcases on the far wall of the office. She seemed to be drinking in every detail of the mahogany shelves, the leather-bound books chosen for their aesthetics rather than their appropriateness to the setting. For the first time in a long time, Karen felt as though her space was being scrutinised and found wanting. Would you like to sit down so we can start? She thought for a second that Jessica was going to ignore her again. But after a moment, she took a seat opposite and sat silently, waiting for Karen to lead the session. Jessica wasn't unattractive. Certainly if her face weren't so ruddied from the cold outside, or perhaps from nerves, she could pass for pretty. Her hair fell in natural kinks down to her shoulders, and was a blonde so dark it looked devoid of colour entirely, a grey mass that had resigned itself to sit on her head without attracting attention. Her whole look was designed to elicit the least amount of interest, it seemed. My name is Dr. Karen Browning. I don't know if you've seen other psychiatrists, but here we like our clients to be comfortable. So I'd like you to call me Karen. Though if you don't want to, that's fine. Similarly, I'd like to call you Jessica. But if you prefer Miss, Mrs., or Miss Hamilton, I'm fine with that too. She threw Jessica a wide smile, hoping to put her at ease. She sympathised with all of her patients. This had to be a daunting experience for them the first time around, sharing their fears and perceived shortcomings with someone who had no reason to care other than the money they were paying them. That was one of the reasons why she tried to look as approachable as possible. No designer labels on her suits like some of the other psychiatrists, no severe bun on the top of her head, and no diamonds the size of Blarney Stone. Not that the last one was her choice. Jessica nodded at the standard spiel as though she had heard something profound, but gave no indication of what she would like to be called. Can I get you a drink? She shook her head almost imperceptibly. Karen got up, poured herself a glass of water from the cooler in the corner, and sat back on the chair facing Jessica. It was purposely an inch lower than the sofa, giving her patience the sense of control that many didn't feel in the outside world. Okay, I noticed that the reason for your visit is tension headaches. Would you like to tell me about them? Jessica's eyes locked onto Karen's, something she wasn't used to, at least in initial sessions. She'd kept her office sparsely decorated so that people didn't have anything to focus on or be distracted by. The sofa, her desk, and two small bookcases. the one photograph, no trinkets, and a large painting of a jetty over a mass of relaxing turquoise water. Yet they still found somewhere to look other than her. Not Jessica Hamilton, though. "You can't fix me." There was a vicious, challenging tone to her voice that was so at odds with her demeanour that it hit Karen harder than the word she'd used. But she had been shocked in her job thousands of times, and she'd got hellish good at concealing her reactions. Her face remained an impassive mask.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.